Dr. John Suber, plastic surgeon, and welcome to Straight Talk on Plastic Surgery. Today I'm going to answer a viewer's question regarding dog ears. But before I delve into that, I want to let you know how appreciative and humbled I am by your kind and gracious comments left for me regarding my first video placed a mere 24 hours ago. The response has been tremendous, and I very much appreciate your kind attention. You've inspired me to continue with this format as a tool to help you, the viewer, have your questions answered regarding plastic surgery. One request I will have for you is that as you have questions for me and you submit them, please do use the email service provided through YouTube. Having questions within the body of the commentary is a little more difficult, I anticipate, for me to keep up with over time. So far, I've jotted them down, and we'll try to address each of those. But in the future, if you can include those in the email, that would be the best way to submit questions so that I'll be sure to be able to read them and address them here via video. Now, dog ears. Let's define them first. Dog ear is an excess pucker of skin and or fat that occurs at the end of a surgical incision. These occur most commonly, for example, at the end of a tummy tuck / abdominoplasty incision, and can even occur in other such incisions, like at the end of a breast reduction surgery, or even surgeries not related to plastic surgery at all. First and foremost, let's talk about how they can occur. These occur first off in an area that I term a transition zone, that is an area where one is operated and transitioning into an area that has not been operated on. So for the abdomen, it would be at the end of the incision on the lateral outside of the abdomen, transitioning into the hip or buttock area. These can occur very commonly with surgery, and in most cases they're avoidable. Sometimes they're not, depending on the patient's physical exam. How are these managed? Well, let me first share with you ways that I use to minimize the risk of their occurrence. Thankfully, so far, these tools have worked well for me, as I rarely see them in my practice, but on occasion we do see these dog ears with surgeries that have been performed on by other surgeons, and we're happy to manage those in the office. There's two things to consider when minimizing the risk of a dog ear. First, you want to make sure that the skin edges lie together well at the outermost aspect of the incision. Sometimes this requires us to take that incision just a little bit longer than initially planned in order to smooth out that incision. Also, it's often necessary to debulk the fatty tissue that lies immediately under that transition zone where the incision ends. This can be managed via a little bit of liposuction in my hands, or debulking of that fatty tissue directly underneath the skin. In any case, the most important thing for your surgeon to do in minimizing the risk is to consider the risk of dog ear at the end of the surgery, during the surgery, and to directly address that at that time. Sometimes dog ears are unavoidable, for example, in a massive weight loss patient where there's a future plan to address excess tissue of the hip or buttocks at a later date. In that case, you would perform your tummy tuck or the abdominoplasty in a manner that debulks as much tissue safely as one can, and then minimize the risk of the dog ear. If that occurs, one is planning on coming back to reoperate on the backside of a patient anyway, and you can incorporate that dog ear excision and repair at that time. Now, if I'm seeing a patient who has a dog ear, again frequently from a surgery performed in a facility outside of my office, I can manage that quite easily, usually in the office. So the third issue to address is how to manage dog ears if you have them already. Usually, and in most patients, that can be handled with a fairly straightforward, simple procedure in my office under local anesthesia. With a patient in a standing position, we simply measure and mark that excess and numb that area up, and then excise or cut out that area and smooth it out. That way the transition zone, that is the area from the end of the incision going into the area that's not been operated on, is smooth and as inconspicuous as possible. I hope that addresses your question regarding dog ears. Again, I encourage your questions. please do email them to me. Remember, no matter where you are, life is good.